you guys walk on out, and I will. Good evening, everybody. My name is Trey Grayson. I'm the director of the Institute of Politics, and I'm pleased to welcome all of you to the John F. Kennedy Jr. Forum for tonight's forum. We're really excited about the topic with the White House photographers here, and we're also pleased that David Gergen, who's the director of the Center for Public Leadership here at the Kennedy School, is going to moderate. And you all know David's background, so I'm not going to give much more of an introduction than that. So please join David and our panel in tonight's forum. Thank you, David.
Thank you. Well, we're going to learn a lot tonight, but we're also going to have some fun because White House photographers, by nature, are artists, and they bring a certain kind of joy
gravitas.
Of life. Yeah, gravitas, the whole thing, and you can tell a couple of there's at least one smartass in the crowd here, and, but it's so interesting because they become such a central part of what goes on within a White House. They are seen but not seen, but they can also develop these relationships with individuals there. And at least one instance here, someone became actually a close-in advisor to a president. But they also give the rest of the world sometimes a more intimate view of what's happening inside. There are sometimes controversies about what pictures to release. But they capture not only the more serious moments, but they also capture the lighter side, as you can imagine, with a place that works 24/7, there's a lot of snoring that goes on, and more than one person has been captured with his mouth open, who's a national security advisor, you know, with his mouth totally wide open and totally out of it, and the world is safe. You know, it gives you such a sense of safety. But what has also struck me over the years is, you know, there's this old cliche that no man is a hero to his valet, because everyone, when seen up close, you see all the flaws. But what has been really wonderful about the White House photographers is that I think they have seen the flaws, but they've also seen the good sides. And they have shown an enormous appreciation and sensitivity to the people they cover. And they've shown a great deal of loyalty. And that, to me, is a mark. They're not only artists, but they're just really fine human beings. So we're welcoming four tonight. And let me tell you how this is sort of going to work. Each one has brought some of his or her photographs. And we're going to look sequentially, starting with President Ford, at four different presidencies through the eyes of the White House photographer. And we'll show some pictures from that presidency, let that person talk a little bit, and then we'll have a general conversation, and we'll open this up to your questions. Is that fair enough? So thank you all for coming. Let me just say, I'm gonna tell you a little bit more about each one just before we get into a conversation. But the four are David Hume Kennerly, who was the White House photographer for President Ford. Then we'll move into David Valdez, who was White House photographer for President George H.W. Bush. Barbara Kinney, who was a White House photographer for President Clinton and also worked with Mrs. Clinton, and Eric Draper, who was a White House photographer for President George W. Bush. So let me start with you, David Hume Kennerly. The one issue we've got with David is if he really lets himself go, no one else will have a chance to speak tonight because he has this personality, has
I'm
been
very respectful.
He's very. He had. There was a time in his life when he was respectful, and that passed long ago. He has known for unprecedented access to major meetings and events throughout the Ford presidency. He was very close to Jerry Ford. He was the one that Ford often. I was there when Ford would often go around the room saying, "What do you think?" And then he would ask David, because he thought David was more down to earth and understood the country so well. As he did, but he is—he's traveled all over the world. He won a Pulitzer Prize for one of his photographs from the Vietnam War. Listen to this: his photos have been featured on the magazine covers, Time, Life, Newsweek, over 50 different times. That's a person who's got a lot of experience in the field. So, David, welcome. Thank you, sir, for coming.
Thank you.
Okay, and let's see if we can make this work. This is the David Kennerly and the Ford presidency. That looks like the end of the Nixon presidency.
That's
but
right.
But you were there.
Well, when this was the day that I got my job as the White House photographer, actually. Richard Nixon resigned. It was August 9th, 1974. I was out there as a Time magazine photographer, and this was really one of the biggest news stories to this day that I've covered, and yeah. You were back there then.
Yeah,
and
I was out there in the lawn watching.
It's really hard to imagine what a dark and exciting, dramatic day it was. People were excited that Nixon was resigning, and I was excited that Ford was going to become president.
Had you signed up already to become
a... No, I had not been offered the job. That night...
Were you shooting this for Time? Who were you shooting this
for? I was shooting for Time magazine, and the night that Nixon resigned, then President Ford, he became president at noon, which is about an hour after Nixon left, had a bunch of people over to his house in Alexandria, a very modest place. I don't know if you ever went over there. And he asked me to come over, and I took some pictures, but he asked me to stay after everybody left. And I'm from Roseburg, Oregon, which is a really small town. And I'd done a lot of stuff, but I'm still a small town guy, and I'm sitting in the living room of Ford's house, and he's the president. And as well as I knew him, it was still a very, I don't know, to this day I think about it, I think, how could that have happened? And he asked if I was interested in the White House job, and how did I see the job? And I'd known that Ollie Atkins had no access. He was only brought in and let in for a couple minutes or less, and I just didn't want that kind of a job. And I told President Ford that I wanted, if I was going to do the job, I wanted total access and to work directly for him, not for the press secretary or the chief of staff. And he's looking at me and puffing on his pipe, and he said, "You don't want Air Force One on the weekends?" And so the next day he called and offered me the job, and after that he was true to his word. I mean, it was one of the most, to this day, the most exciting thing I think I've ever done for 2.5 years as his photographer.
And this is Ford at work in serious deliberations?
The end of the Vietnam War, it was in this room, which it's a rather ironic moment that under a portrait of Teddy Roosevelt in the Roosevelt room that no one's talking. The director of the CIA is in there, Henry Kissinger, the Secretary of Defense, Deputy Secretary, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, literally made the decision to pull out the final Americans out of Vietnam.
This was the moment?
At that moment. That was it. He decided it. Nobody said anything. I think it's conceivably one of the most important pictures I made because it ended an era, a very dismal era for Americans. And I spent 2.5 years in Vietnam myself and watching it all end. I was in the room when it ended, and I'd been over there. So it was, I had a whole different perspective on it.
Wow, that's really interesting. This is a very different view of President Ford, unless...
This is a picture that kept him off the best dressed list. of course, the guy on the right is Chief of Staff Donald Rumsfeld. And
that's a young
Rummy is so tight, he probably still has the same suit. I wouldn't have. But I think the thing about this photo, it gives you an idea of the kind of access. President Ford was the least vain person I've ever taken pictures of. I mean, no politician would normally allow themselves to be photographed like this, but I was in every meeting,
This is over in the residence.
No, this was in the Akasaka Guest Palace in Tokyo in 1974, and President Ford was the first president to visit Japan.
Is that when he had the tuxedo that was 3 inches too short for him? Looks like
he didn't wear that when he met the emperor. But people really would have written some bad stuff at that point. But there, his aides, the military aide, and his
Terry O'Donnell with his back.
Yes, yeah. I love this next one because it captures the spirit. I think it shows a lot about President Ford, this next photograph, and the woman he married.
Yeah, you probably won't see that picture again before or since. The photograph was taken on January 19th, 1977. It was the day before the Fords left office after losing to Carter. And Mrs. Ford was going around the West Wing and saying goodbye to all the staff and looked into this bastion of male dominance. I mean, the very few women have ever sat around that table as members of the cabinet. And she looked in there and said, you know, I've always wanted to dance on the cabinet room table. And she was a former Martha Graham dancer, a great sense of humor. I love this person, and she's done so many good things with her life. And she just took her shoes off, hopped up, and struck that pose. And I took the photo, and I was telling these folks a little earlier, I have the only signed picture of this. And I think that...
Has that ever seen it? I've never seen it.
Oh, it's been published.
Has it been published?
Well, it had not been published until I was doing a book, and I wanted to put it in the book, but I didn't want to just say, could I use this picture? It's in the archive. And this is about 1991 or two, and I took the layouts to President Ford. I wanted them to see it in context. And Mrs. Ford wasn't there and was coming later. He goes through and he's looking at all these pictures. It was a great shot of him in Texas with all these Texas Ranger ads. Oh, I remember that day. And it got to this one. It was one of those cartoon moments where the eyes came out. And he said, oh, Betty's not going to like this. And I thought, oh, man, I'm sunk. You know, he knows her better than anybody. And so she came in later, looked through it, and saw this and started laughing and said, oh, I remember that. I haven't seen the picture. I said, so you don't mind if I use it in the book? And she said, no, that's great. And President Ford looked and said, well, Betty, you never told me you did that.
Final shot.
Reagan and Ford, this is Governor Reagan in 1974 at the... at a hotel in Los Angeles. And I don't think Reagan had decided he was running for the presidency at this point, but the only election Reagan ever lost was to Ford during the 76 presidential primaries, when Ford barely got the nomination. And I think the Republican hearts and minds really wanted Reagan to have that job. And you remember distinctly what it was like back then. And the convention was not a preordained job like nowadays. It was fought right to the bitter end. And then, of course, Reagan goes on to become president later.
Terrific. David, thank you. Thank you. We'll keep moving on with David Valdez, who was with became the photographer for President Bush Sr., President George H.W. Bush. Now, it's interesting. David Valdez was trained as a photographer as an enlisted man in the United States Air Force. I think that's just terrific. I think that's a wonderful sign of working your way up, what the military can also impart, and it's a wonderful part of your life. He served in a number of departments and as a photographer, but he became a personal photographer to Vice President George H.W. Bush. So vice presidents often have personal photographers as well, and when Vice President Bush was elected in 1988. He went with him to the White House. He was director of the Office of Photography there. He was there throughout the Bush years, traveled to 75 countries, all 50 states. And he's been published, like David Kennerly, in a number of different publications. And he's also published a book, George Herbert Walker Bush, A Photographic Profile. David, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And it must have been a wonderful experience. Bush was very much like Ford. He was a real gentleman.
Yeah, we used to joke and actually had more fun when he was vice president, because as you know, it's a smaller staff. Yeah. And I was born in Alice, Texas. It's a very small little town in South Texas.
What was it?
Alice.
Alice. Alice, Texas. Texas. Like Alice's restaurant?
Yeah.
Okay.
The same menu though, Dave.
No. And so, you know, actually President Bush was born in Massachusetts, but, you know, he was always a Texan at heart. And we used to travel around the world, and as we would go in to meet with the Pope or, you know, the head of the Soviet Union or somebody like that, and he'd kind of give me a little elbow, and he'd say, can you believe two guys from Texas are here doing this? So it was always kind of fun, but when I interviewed for the job when he was vice president, I had the interview with the press secretary at the time, Shirley Green, and the chief of staff, and then with the vice president. And when I got there, he was telling me, you know, you're going to spend a lot of time with me in public and in private. And I was like, okay. But at that point, no one had told me what the salary was. And so I said, well, do you know what the salary is? He says, well, I have no idea. So he called up Admiral Murphy, and I could hear him. This was in the old executive office building. And I could hear him screaming through the walls, what? Valdez is asking you about salary? But then when he was elected president, when he was president-elect, he asked me to stay on. I stayed on those four more years.
Terrific. Well, let's go to the photographs. This first one, tell us what's going on. That's clearly President Bush at the table and Colin Powell.
Yeah, this is in the Oval Office. This is at the end of Desert Storm. And
this is a decision when he was trying to decide whether to go to stop or not?
To end it. And actually, Colin Powell is on the phone with General Schwarzkopf. And it was after that quick period of time after Iraq invaded Kuwait.
Is that it looks like John Sununu as chief of staff. Is that to his left? Is that a young Bob Gates?
Yes. Uh-huh. And back is the Secretary of Defense, Cheney.
Gates was CIA, right?
Right.
Yeah. So where was the Secretary of State?
There's no Secretary of State in there. It, on the right, with his back to us, is
is Defense Secretary.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Cheney.
Okay, interesting. Moving on.
This is at the opening of the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library.
This was the Reagan Presidential Library?
Yes.
Nixon was still alive then?
Yes.
Apparently, he's in the picture.
Yeah.
Very important.
Well, no, but I kept on thinking that he died before that. I was wondering whether
we have evidence.
I was wondering whether it was the Nixon Library. That was what I was wondering.
He was.
Well, it's funny. I actually also photographed the opening of the Nixon Library, but this one is actually at the Reagan Library, and so President Bush is the president in this one, and it was kind of funny. Just moments before this, we were in the mock-up of the Oval Office, and I took President Bush, they were all in there, and I said to President Bush, Mr. President, turn around for a photo, and they all turned, and I got a shot of them all together. But then this was just a few moments later as they came out.
I wondered if it also conveys some of the spirit that this is actually a very small fraternity of people who have been presidents, and they actually have... They, despite their huge differences, they can actually become friends. I mean, in this case, Jimmy Carter and Gerry Ford were bitter enemies, political enemies, but they became friends over time.
Well, it's classic. Senior President Bush and President Clinton.
Yes, exactly.
Have become close friends.
You've seen that, Barbara.
And so it's a small fraternity. It's kind of like our little group.
Yeah, we used to hate each other.
This is in China. Early on in his career, President Bush was the U.S. liaison to the People's Republic of China, and then we visited there, and this was actually in Tiananmen Square a couple of months before there was actually...
Just before Tiananmen Square.
Right.
That's probably the last time anybody smiled in that square. All right, that's interesting. I like this picture a lot. Is this up at Camp David?
This is Camp David. President Gorbachev was up at Camp David, and they were having some meetings. And earlier on in the day, President Gorbachev, they took a break from their meetings, and he went walking on the grounds at Camp David. And I followed along just to see what he was going to be doing. And he got to the horseshoe pit. And
Who won? Do you remember?
It was President Gorbachev, his interpreter, and me. They get to the horseshoe pit, and they're like bantering, what is this? And so I showed President Gorbachev how to throw the horseshoe. So he threw the first shoe and got a ringer.
Whoa.
So he kept the shoe And I went over and I told the president that President Gorbachev just stole your horseshoe. So that night, President Bush got the other horseshoe mounted on a plaque and presented it to him.
Terrific. One doesn't appreciate until you really get there just how important the informality
Absolutely.
Of these relationships is. It's as important in many ways as the substance in terms of developing the relationship.
Well, you know, because I spent so many years with President Bush, I got to see, because he had been head of the CIA, and
right.
he was our ambassador to the United Nations, and over all those years, he got to meet a lot of people who were from around the world who had kind of moved up. So when he became president, he had already interacted with a lot of these people in other capacities. So as president, I think he had a closer relationship with a lot of folks, and it really helped him embrace them and understand some of the thought process that they went through.
Yeah. There are also moments of loneliness in the presidency.
Well, here's one where they're all in bed up at Kinney.
No, I missed that one. I'm sorry. Yeah, I did. That's not loneliness. Go ahead. The one was out of order. Good. Yeah, please tell me. Who are all these? I mean, what I really love about this picture, did President Bush just wake up here?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's been shocking to find you in the room.
The story behind the photo, they were on vacation up in Kenny Bunkport, and that's at in their bedroom at Walker's Point, Kenny Bunkport. And Life magazine wanted to send a photographer up to photograph them while they were on vacation. And he said, no, I'm on vacation. And so Life magazine really wanted the photos. And so I was offered up and said, well, you know, I'll take some pictures. So I talked to Barbara Bush, you know, about, you know, some other things that we could do. And she says, you just got to come over to the bedroom like 6 o'clock in the morning and just wait, see what happens. And so at their house, when you go walk into the, like the side door there, you've probably been there.
Yeah.
There's a little laundry room, and then right to the left is the bedroom. And so I went in and, you know, kind of peeked around, and they were in there alone. I sat on there's a little couch right there, and just kind of waited, and all the grandchildren just started coming in, and I just started snapping away. And we sent this to Life magazine, and wound up running a double truck in Life magazine, and then over the years, Life kept bringing it back as Best of Life and Classic Moments in Life, and it's one of my favorite photos because it really shows the family side, and as Eric knows, the Bush family is very large, and they embrace a lot of people, and I was fortunate enough to be able to step inside of that for a few years.
Yeah, it's I'm just personal aside. The first time I ever went to Kennebunk, it was before he was president, and he had a Democratic member of Congress there for the weekend. Friend, I really thought that's the old spirit of politics.
Well,
Republican, you know, leader, he's got a Democratic friend there for the weekend, just as a friend, quiet, no publicity.
Something that was probably a little lost in history, when he was deciding to run for Congress in Texas as a Republican, he went to President Johnson
right.
and asked his advice on if he should do it, and so it was kind of interesting, you know, Republican and Democrat, and he's literally going to him for advice whether he should run for Congress,
yeah.
and you know, it was a neat kind of dynamic there. That was a Texas connection there.
Interesting. Let's see. I there were two photographs. I'm sorry, but we're going to move on.
You want to go back?
We can go back. I don't. There were two photographs. I thought were in this pile, but I have. There's
there
one.
You go.
And there, we've seen those. Okay, good. We will go on. And thank you, David. Those were lovely stories. And Barbara, let's move on to the Clintons. Been a photojournalist in Washington for some 21 years. Served as a White House photographer for President Bill Clinton. We're going to see one of her most memorable photographs in just a moment, for which she won a World Press Photo Foundation First Place Award. She was also Hillary Clinton's personal campaign photographer during the Clintons, during Hillary's 2008 bid for the Democratic presidential nomination. She's worked as a picture editor and a photographer for USA Today and Reuters, and she currently lives in Seattle. And like the other three here, is active as a photographer. Barbara, it says a lot about your relationship with the Clintons that Mrs. Clinton would reach out to you and ask you to continue working with the family.
Well, I reached out to her, actually, because when she announced that she was going to run for president, I thought, wow, this is a historical race, and I need to be there to document it. Plus, I knew that if she won, if I was her campaign photographer, that would bring me back to the White House. But it was, you know, it was I knew that it needed to be documented, so I just had to talk her and her staff into bringing me on, and it was, and once I was there, it was, at the end of the campaign, her assistant, Huma, said to me that I was the second most important person on the campaign plane, Hillary being the first, so they realized how important it was. So.
And what was your overall experience like working with the Clintons?
I love the Clintons dearly, and it was an amazing experience for me to be able to work in the White House and, you know, our jobs or document the presidency. So, you know, you got to be in on everything from the political meetings to the personal stuff, which, you know, maybe worked a lot, but you got to go on vacation when they went on vacation to document it. So it was, you know, it was a real special time for me.
Terrific.
To be able to see that.
Let's look at this first one. It looks like serious negotiations underway.
Yes. Well, this is one of my favorite pictures, and I thought it would be good for this crowd because it's a very a political picture. Not everyone really gets the eye contact of this picture, but this was right after the 96 election when President Clinton had beaten Bob Dole, and this was a budget.
Is this the first time since the election?
I don't know that it was the first time, but it was one of the budget meetings, you know, that went on for like a week or so, and it was just a really intense moment. And
it looks like Newt Gingrich is on the right there having a little fun.
Yeah.
It looks like he's enjoying Clinton going after Bob Dole, actually. Which may well be true. This is Clinton as he is so often, intense, with an Al Gore looking contemplative, but not quite as intense.
Yeah.
This is in the Oval Office, and that chair that the president sits in is traditionally the president's chair, and with everyone sort of taking their other assigned seats. This is a different moment with President Clinton. Tell us where this is.
This was in Ghana. We were doing probably five or six country trip to Africa, and this was in Ghana. This was our first stop. These people had been out waiting for the president for just hours, and it was hot and it was crowded, and I was up on a press stand, luckily, and you know Clinton, he, you know, has to shake hands with everybody, so he just reached out for the crowd, and the agents were trying to keep him back because he's pretty close in there, so it was a great
if he thing. Had his choice, he would have touched every hand there, right?
And we'd still be there.
We'll still be there, right? exactly. I love this next photograph. This is the one that's so memorable.
This was during the Mideast peace signing at the White House. You probably all remember the picture out on the South Lawn with Arafat and Rabin and the president in the middle. I was inside, and they were getting ready to be announced out into the East Room for a press conference. And I was standing there, and they'd been in there for a while, the president had given them all a tour of the Red Room and was really running out of things to say because they were still setting up outside. But anyway, they got lined up as they were going to be announced out. And I was shooting with a Leica, which is a rangefinder, so it's kind of hard to focus. And I was kind of focusing on the president, and Stephen Gooden, who was his assistant, was behind me and said, "Mr. President, you need to straighten your tie." And like every man, immediately they all do this, and I saw it. I had my camera up like this, and I saw it out of this side, and I was like, oh my gosh. And I fired off three frames. It was manual advance, and boom, they were announced, and they were out. And I was like, wow, that was really funny. Stephen, did you see that? That was really funny. I wonder if Arafat wears a tie. I wonder if that's in focus. Oh, isn't that funny? And all these things going through my head, and got back to the photo editing office later that day, and I said to our picture editor, I have this picture that, she said, the Thai picture. I said, yeah, is it in focus? Yeah. So I knew she showed it to me. I was like, wow, I took that. That's pretty good. And I'm still amazed. And anyway, we released it to Life magazine, and they ran it, Double Truck. And
that's the second time Double Truck has come out.
Double Truck.
Explain what Double Truck is.
And when you open up a magazine, the two pages, you know, so it runs really big.
So it opens up?
Yeah.
Like that?
Yeah, it kind of bleeds from one page to the next. So,
David gets the covers. We get the Double Trucks.
You got.
I got a couple.
They'll have a response to that.
But that picture, if you look at all the people in it, I mean, Arafat's gone, Rabin is gone, King Hussein, and now Mubarak is out, and that's a great photo. It's one of my favorite pictures.
And just so you all know, David, every time I see him, he still owes me a print because he got this print, a copy of this, and he says he keeps saying he's going to send me one, but hasn't. So, but the other thing about this picture, it keeps reappearing when something that happens in the Mideast, like recently with the Mubarak stuff. I didn't see it, but apparently it ran in the New York Times. You know, so it's a historical photo that keeps popping up, which is nice.
A more poignant moment.
This was the inauguration day, the second term, and they were getting ready to go out to all the different balls that happened that evening, and they were actually getting ready to pose for a portrait that I think my boss at that time, Bob McNeely, was taking, so I was just sort of documenting what was going on. And
tell me, these are all black and whites.
Yeah.
These are original black and
yes.
white. Yes. I'm curious about why, because we've been going from color back to your black and
well,
white.
Well, our main job, at least in the Clinton White House, you know, was to shoot color. We were shooting film back then. There's this historical and sort of a historical feeling to the black and white. And so I would carry a Leica around and shoot sort of what I thought would be a nice black and white picture that. With that, a Leica and black and white film allowed you to shoot in lower light situations. The Leica was smaller, so it was quieter. So it was just sort of something that I did, and the other photographers I worked with did, you know, on the side. Even though I probably have this in color too, maybe not that moment, but the same situation. But and as I edit my photos to show and talk about them, it's just the black and white just has a lovely historical sense to it.
This was a striking photograph.
I'm not sure this reproduces very well on the screen, but this was a First Lady's event at the Botanical Gardens in D.C. And what's interesting about this is Jackie Kennedy was invited to it. She was still alive, but was too sick to attend, and ended up dying just a couple of weeks later. But they were all sitting around in the back before they were going to be asked out on the stage, onto the stage. And what's funny is, which is interesting that you mentioned the color film, they're all wearing these pastel ball gowns. So it is kind of a striking picture in color, but I just love their faces in this, and I think the black and white just allows you to look at the faces.
Nancy Reagan looks very, very engaged.
And I always feel really bad about this because, you know, it sort of makes her look like she's not paying attention or has nothing to do with the other ladies. She's actually looking at a TV camera that was in the corner that was showing what was going on the stage.
Yeah, which was probably more interesting.
Yeah, right. So hopefully she doesn't hate me for this.
Did I miss one there? Okay, let's go back. This is Bill Clinton in isolation.
And you would think that, and that's what's funny about our jobs, is that, you know, there were probably, you know, 5 or 10 people behind me roaming around in the Oval Office, but, you know, you're able to sort of editorialize a little bit, and he was looking out the window after a state visit, people leaving the South Lawn, and I just thought it looked like a nice moment that he looked isolated.
Somehow the Bubba picture fell out. I'm not sure where that fell out.
Oh, there's a...
What's that?
There's a picture.
We had a Bubba picture, but somebody edited that out. There's a Democrat here somewhere edited this out, but it's all right.
Maybe it'll pop up.
Maybe it'll pop up here somewhere else. Okay, so we will move on to President. It's very fine. Thank you, Barbara, very much. And finally, we will move to Eric Draper. Thank you, Eric, for coming here. He was the White House photographer for President George W. Bush, you converted the White House photographic office from film to digital. Right. While you were there. Before he worked in the Bush White House, he was news photographer for AP, with covering both the 96 and 2000 presidential campaigns, the 2000 Olympics, the Kosovo conflict. There's a lot of these folks have been in war conflict zones. And the World Cup, now based in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
That's correct.
Wow. All right. Are you still, you're still taking pictures there?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's very different out there than Washington. It's like the opposite of Washington. But very happy to be there.
I was going to say, do you miss Washington?
No. I miss the people, of course.
Yeah. When I first saw this first photograph, I thought it might be from the debate between President Bush Sr. and Bill Clinton, the famous debate moment, but it actually happened in the George W. Bush.
Yeah, this photo was taken the first week of the administration, and I was actually very lucky to capture this picture because it happened at a fraction of a second, and I was in the right place at the right time, and actually, it's a good example of how timely President Bush was because
very time sensitive.
Exactly. I mean, you can set your watch to a schedule. For example, he's an early riser. He would get up at 5:30. When we're in the White House, he would arrive in the Oval Office either at 7 o'clock or before 7 o'clock, so I had to be ready to go typically at 6:30 in the morning, very, very early. But the best part was that he went to bed at a reasonable hour.
I see.
And the Secret Service just loved that fact, actually.
Yeah. not exactly Clinton time,
yeah,
right, Barbara?
I couldn't set my watch by him.
You couldn't set your calendar, could you? The day of the week. All right. I'm not quite sure what's going on in this next photograph. Tell us about it.
Well, this is one of those unscripted moments, which actually was really fun to wait for these moments to happen. Between all of the formality and the protocol and the schedule, this moment was just a few seconds. And this is actually one of the president's dogs, Miss Beasley. And the president had two Scottish Terriers, and you all may know the other Scottish Terrier, Barney. But Miss Beasley was more affectionate, and you may remember Barney actually bit a reporter. You guys remember that part, so yeah. Barney was had a different personality.
Did the president celebrate that?
You know, he probably got a chuckle out of it, actually.
All right. But I think that one doesn't often appreciate that this he could also be a very thoughtful person.
Yeah, this actually was one of the most intense moments during my 8 years in the White House. This was the moment after the president decided to commit troops to Iraq. And actually, let me just set this up a little bit. There was definitely a moment that was building to this. The president, just a few days before this, had given the ultimatum speech to Saddam Hussein. And so I was kind of waiting for this moment, and I was standing outside the Situation Room where he actually met with his national security team, including a teleconference with his commanders in the field. And back then, the Situation Room had a peephole. You can actually kind of monitor what was going on in the meeting. And I saw the meeting break up, and the president bolted out of the door of the Situation Room, and I saw the emotion on his face. I mean, his eyes were red. He was almost tearing up, and I literally had to jump out of the way for him to pass. And knowing that he was very emotional, I followed him up the stairs. He walked through the Oval Office, and he walked the entire circle of the South Lawn. And so I decided to wait for him to approach me, and that's what you see here in this moment, which actually, right after I took this picture, he actually spoke to me, which typically in a normal day, you know, I try to fade in the background and not engage. Well, he said to me, Eric, are you interested in history? And I said, and I was like, you know, shaking in my boots. And I said, yes, sir. And he said, these pictures you're making are very important, the one in the Situation Room and the one here on the South Lawn. And out of the corner of my eye, just as he said that, Vice President Cheney and Don Rumsfeld, who was the Defense Secretary, they walked out of the Oval Office and they met to discuss the start of the war. And it was very, 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 very intense.
Mm. It was an intense moment. The transition after the elections?
Correct. Yeah, this was a few days after the election in November.
This is the first meeting?
The very first meeting. The very first time President-elect Obama was in the Oval Office, and they're meeting for the first time. And again, another very tense moment. And actually, no one else was allowed in the Oval Office because they just wanted the two of them alone. And I knew this was a very important picture, so I actually made this picture with a remote camera. And
I'm not in the room.
I'm actually firing the camera from outside the Oval Office.
Oh, interesting.
And because I knew that it would be hard to get like a real moment between the two because it was so tense. Because I was actually on the other side of the coffee table there, and they're both looking at me like, okay, are you done yet? Because they really wanted to start the meeting. So luckily I had that camera set up ahead of time, and actually I had to talk President Bush into allowing me to set the camera up. And I didn't ask him, actually. The secretary at the time said, well, why don't you just put it there and see what he says? And 7 o'clock, and he shows up in the Oval, he sits down at his desk and looks up and he's like, what's that? And everyone looks at me. And I said, well, Mr. President, that's the camera for your meeting with the president-elect. And he said, okay, well, let's make sure you tell President-elect Obama because we don't want him to think we're trying to spy on him.
So, fair enough.
Yeah, so I got lucky.
Interesting picture. This is, where are we here?
9/11.
Yeah. Okay, yes, this is down in the, I don't know where he is. Is this when he was out, this is on 9/11 itself?
This
is when he was flying out into the Midwest?
Actually, this is before we left Florida.
Okay.
And this
he was getting word there. Andy Carter just told him about
right.
the first flight.
Right. He was told inside the classroom, and this is in the hold room just a few minutes later, talking on the phone. And for me, I was waiting for President Bush to watch the television set, because everyone was transfixed on that image.
Yeah.
And they had the TV with a live cable that was playing, and the two towers were burning, and they started replaying the second tower getting hit. And that's the moment here, Dan Bartlett, who was the communications advisor at the time, and he's alerting everyone to the room because it was the first time we'd ever seen it. We heard that it happened. And I made another image of the president turning around to see that image that's burned in everyone's memory.
Wow. This is the same day.
Same day, aboard Air Force One. We had just departed Florida. And at this moment, the president is being told that he cannot return to Washington. And he was not happy.
He does not look happy.
No. And
he also looks much younger, if I may add. It's striking how much younger he looks in that photograph.
Yeah. And again, another very intense moment. I'm literally standing, just a couple of feet away, but it really felt like I wasn't there. And just something that was really interesting. There were a lot of these historic moments through the years, and a lot of times they're so historic that I really feel like I blend to the background and disappear. And actually, the president asked me one day, he said, Eric, were you on the plane on 9/11? and I said, yes, I was. And so it was really interesting that, he didn't remember the fact, that he was so focused on the situation at hand.
Yeah.
That
This moment was one of the high points of his presidency.
Yeah, this was the moment at Ground Zero. And actually, that entire day was a roller coaster of emotion. This was about 3 days after the attacks. The president started out in Washington where we had attended a service at the National Cathedral. It was a day of national prayer. He toured Ground Zero, met with hundreds of firefighters that were there. And the firefighters were tired, they were angry. And then this is another just pretty like an unscripted moment in terms of what he said through the bullhorn. And the firefighter that was screaming, I can't hear you. Yeah. And actually, being in the White House for 8 years, I was able to witness stories that would come full circle. In this case, I actually met that firefighter who said, "I can't hear you." And it was about four years.
The president's response.
Exactly. The president's response was, "I can hear you, and the people who knocked these buildings down will hear from all of us soon." And that was that moment. And so that firefighter showed up at a rally, a political rally in Pennsylvania, and he was screaming in the crowd, "I can't hear you, I can't hear you." And I looked over, and I'm like, and he said, I'm the guy. And so I got him backstage, and he had a meeting with the president. It was very emotional, and they're both tearing up. The firefighter said, "Mr. President, you know, my son's going to West Point. You changed my life." And the president stopped him, and he said, "No, you changed my life." And it was a very, very powerful moment. Wow. This was, the president would meet with injured soldiers, like dozens and dozens of visits to Walter Reed, to Bethesda, and he would also give out Purple Hearts to the soldiers. And that's what this image shows here, kissing the forehead of a soldier that I believe was injured in Afghanistan, and his parents are back there after the soldier received the Purple Heart.
You all have had wonderful memories to share, and it's very these are poignant photographs. Thank you. Thanks to all four of you. I want to open this up to the thank you. And you should know, as we meet here, thanks to the Institute of Politics and here at the Kennedy School Forum, that we're joined by C-SPAN audience for this occasion. And I told these good folks, I said, you know, we have a lot of interesting people that come through here. We've had people, some of the most powerful people in the world come. We don't always see C-SPAN. You guys come, they're there. You know, so thank you. So,
say something, right?
Yeah, it says like something.
Who is the most powerful person?
Yeah, exactly.
Camera.
Camera doesn't lie, does it? Right? Camera doesn't lie. So, let me ask you one question, and let's open this up. You know that there's been a stir about what the role of the White House photographer is, and this was after, I think, the president took the oath of office, that President Obama took the oath of office. And remember, there was some issue about whether the oath had been misapplied by or misread by the Chief Justice, and they came back and did it again just to make sure that there were no constitutional issues. And that was an occasion when the White House photographer took the picture, but no outside photographers were allowed in. And there was an outcry from the photographic press corps saying, "We're being muzzled, we're being manipulated." Where do the lines get drawn here about what the representatives of the press corps can get versus what the White House photographer get? How should those lines be drawn?
I could speak to my period there. I always wanted outside photographers to get their own pictures whenever possible. I mean, but you can't have outside photographers in there all the time. But I think in an occasion like that, there would have been no reason not to have a pool of photographers, which it wasn't a secret moment. It was something that happened. They got off on the wrong foot with that one, actually, because it raised this big cry about it. And I always thought if there were to release a photo, if it was something important like President Ford making that decision to go out of Vietnam, that was important. It was a top secret meeting because it wasn't announced that they were doing that. That was then all the military operation came to bear. But there are a lot of times where I don't understand why they don't have a press pool go in. I mean, it just doesn't make sense. Situation with every administration.
Yeah, well, only if you're a professional photographer, I would assume most of you would believe it's for more openness rather than less openness. That is a general proposition. The White House ought to be a fairly open.
That's right. I don't see why they don't do it more than they do, because it's just there's no reason not to. But it is time consuming. I mean, there is a, you've been. Right. We've practically lived in there too, so.
Well, I think also from back in, when you were there, and even before, the press
Herbert
pool.
Hoover.
The press pool was smaller. I mean, there's quite a gaggle, and so you really have to limit the numbers that come in if you want to do something that's sort of special like the oath. But then, you know how many photographers there are now. It's a stampede, literally, to go out onto the South Lawn to get set up. Not for us, because we were special, but you know, for the press pool, it's, you know, they run out. And the first time I was ever at the White House, which was during Reagan for an event, I was at USA Today. I got trampled as I was trying to get out because I didn't know what I was doing. So there's so many photographers. And
that's a good point.
I think that's the scare that is now, you know, in the administration.
But that doesn't answer the question, though.
I agree, but yeah. Don't you think that's part of why
it's part of it?
It's probably part of the reason, you know, because it's pure logistics.
It's an excuse.
Yeah. But it's used as an excuse.
Right, because you can still do it as a pool with like a small amount of people going in. That's a kind of an established
thing. Part of the complexity in the situation, like I had the same situation after 9/11, after the war started in Iraq, where the sensitivity was so huge that, you know, having, just like you said, having the photographers come through, it's usually all or none that would want to come through. They didn't want to play favorites, for example. That would be a problem if you favored one photographer over another. So, I mean, it was always very, very, there's just more complexity involved. And at the same time, from a communications standpoint, which, you know, I didn't have that responsibility of deciding who would get access. I mean, if they asked for my opinion, I would definitely chime in. But I didn't have that control. It was controlled by the communications office.
Yeah, well, it is sometimes, it's hard to believe how much of an explosion there's been in the number of people, both photographers as well as reporters and others. I think when Harry Truman called the White House press corps and asked the entire White House press corps to come to his office to announce the dropping of the atomic bomb, I think there were less than 50 people who were there, and they're now accredited to the White House for press purposes, I think somewhere around 1,500. It's a substantial change that's occurred there.
The space has increased. I mean, it's still a little tiny press room.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Who makes the decision about which of your photographs to release?
I used to work with Marlon Fitzwater, who
used to work with the press secretary.
Yeah, but sometimes you'd be in a situation, and I would come out and say, Marlon, this just happened, and we would go, but there were some occasions where he would say to me, well, we know that this is coming down the pike, let's release a photo of this. And it was usually something at Camp David or some odd place, because we tried to be open in terms of letting photographers in, but we didn't have that large of a press pool back in those days, so it was a little bit easier. I know on the day that the Gulf War started, Desert Storm, I got called up to the Oval Office not knowing what I was going to be photographing, and I went in and I realized this is the start of the war, and I started taking pictures, but it was so highly classified that they wouldn't let me out of the Oval Office, and I was in there for hours on end and going back into the back study and waiting a little while, and things would change and I'd come back in from the back study, but they wouldn't let me out because it was so classified. And so that was another odd situation. I, you know, 9/11 with Eric, I mean, he was the guy because it's such a closed environment.
Yeah, it's interesting. So there's the microphones here, just come up, identify yourself, please. Kennedy School rules. One, and they're shared mics, one question per customer, and all questions end with a question mark. Please.
All right, thank you very much for coming. My name is Andel Koster. I'm a second year master in public policy student. As you know, the current White House photographer has a Flickr stream, which is fascinating to watch. And I'm curious to know, from your point of view, how has the internet, in terms of the immediacy of the publication of content and the sheer quantity of content that you can publish, changed the job of the White House photographer?
I think that's a mixed blessing. I think it's great that the photographer has an opportunity to get those images out. Flip side to that is in our day, if a White House photo was released, that was a special thing, and everybody waited for that, and so there was an anticipation of a White House photo release. Now, any one of us could go, and I think David said earlier, well, this is President Obama 3 minutes ago doing whatever. So I think it kind of diminishes the value of the White House photo.
I think it diminishes the value of any outsiders coming in. It used to be a really big deal to get a behind-the-scenes time with the president. But like I did it as the White House photographer, but I also encouraged other people to come in and shoot their own pictures. Now, you have the feeling you've seen everything there is to see about Barack Obama. I mean, they're very restrictive about the kids, which I understand. You hardly ever see released pictures of them. But if they called up right now and said, how would you like to come in and spend a day with the president? I would say, sure, I'll do it. But I just would have the feeling that all the pictures or most situations have been done. And Pete Souza, by the way, is one hell of a good photographer, and he doesn't miss anything.
He's the current photographer.
He's the current photographer. He was also during the Reagan administration working with Mike Evans. And he's so good, like Eric and the rest of us all know what we're doing in the way of shooting pictures. So there's not a lot of unexplored territory there for an outside photographer to go
That's
in
interesting.
And do something.
So there has been this, so it's taken some of the magic away to have many photographs.
I can sympathize a little bit with what's currently happening, because during my time in the White House, the explosion of the internet happened, for example.
Yeah.
The 24-hour cable news cycle, and then also the requests that would come through constantly from the networks, from the online magazines, from the newspapers. And what we tried to do was help fulfill those requests. And then share it with everyone. So it was a natural progression, like an evolution, especially with the explosion of the internet. For example, the White House website was another place, another venue for photos, which during the Clinton administration, it wasn't very big, but then we relaunched the website and it was huge, and it just grew from that point.
Yes, sir.
Hi, thank you all so much for being here. My name is Michael Cheyenne. I'm a freshman at the college. My question's for Ms. Kinney. So President Clinton is kind of seen as this master of body language, and a lot of classes I've taken, you know, the picture that he's standing with his arms open kind of like this. How attentive do you have to be to body language, and how important do you think that is for the impact and meaning of the photo?
That's a good question. I mean, I think it's very important, and I think that as each of us worked with our presidents, you get to know the body language. You anticipate what, you know, he might do. You anticipate he's going to go towards the crowd and reach out this way, so you can get a little bit ahead of what you think he might do. You know, is he going to turn right or left to go this way? The body language says a picture. You know, tells your picture. It's what's most important. So I think, I think that it's a great observation.
Please.
I was wondering if you guys would be willing to share maybe a time when you missed the opportunity to take a picture and the regrets that you maybe have till this day.
The picture that would stand out in my mind have always been the ones I missed. I remember those way more than I do than the ones that I took. And I think all of us have had that experience a number of times.
You know, in my case, when the Challenger blew up and I was working for the vice president, and President Reagan asked him to go down to Florida to meet with the families, and I went along, and we went into the building there in at NASA, and we're walking down the hallway to go into the room to meet with the families. And I asked the vice president, I said, what do you think? What's your feeling on me going in there? And he didn't respond. And so as a human being, I chose not to do that, not to walk into that room. And I think about it to this day. You know, should I have done that? But out of respect for those people, maybe it was the better thing the way it happened. But I would love to have gone and done that. But no one told me no. And we had that brief moment of conversation, and he didn't respond. And it's kind of a body language thing. You know, it's like without saying anything, you get that sense like, thank you, but no thank you.
And I think that, you know, as we each did our jobs and you become more familiar with the first family and they with you, you can push the boundaries a little bit and you know sort of when you can be there, when you shouldn't be there. Not always, sometimes you guess wrong, but you develop a relationship so that you are more comfortable in those sensitive situations. But you also have to decide when it's best just to give up a picture and not go for it, that maybe the result isn't.
I had a kind of a non-spoken thing with Barbara Bush when you were in a private situation and with the family, or, you know, they'd be with Billy Graham or somebody in the residence, and she would take her glasses off and they'd be having conversation. When I saw her put her glasses on, I knew that she was saying to me, that's it.
As only Barbara could do.
Yeah. And so it wasn't ever.
Strong message to follow.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to, please, and as you ask us, I must slip away. Trey Grayson is going to continue this, and so stay standing. We're going to go on. Please ask your question. And thank you all very
thank
much.
Thank you.
Okay, good. Thank you.
My name is Lisa King. I'm a mid-career student here at the Kennedy School. I'm also a writer and photographer, and as one of my jobs in my life. And David, I actually have been to Roseburg because we were there for an OTR.
Sorry.
We were there for an OTR stop during the Obama campaign when I was on traveling press briefly. But I wanted to ask a question about the role of being the official documentarian for the president, for the presidency. And ask each one of you who you really felt that you worked for. Was it the government, the executive office, the president himself, or the American people, and how that framed your sense of your job?
For me, it was not even a question. I mean, I was getting paid as a White House photographer. I was on the White House staff. But I had a very clear understanding with the president that my primary job was really taking pictures just not of him every day, but everything that was going on. And so I was doing it for history. That's not to say that those pictures could be used for being signed and given out and all that, but I was in it for the history. That was the most important part. That always took precedent. I didn't feel that I was being a flack for him. I was taking the same pictures that I, whether I was on the payroll of the White House or not, I think that was important. Was it a PR job? The pictures could have been used to show the president in this situation or that. You could say that's good PR for him, showing him doing his job. But I think the important thing was I wasn't taking pictures any differently than if I just come in from the outside. I mean, I didn't change gears there. So it was for the history, that was the main thing.
Yeah, I was kind of that same way. I felt, what an opportunity to document history. And I had actually been a photographer in the government prior to the White House. And one of my jobs was actually a photographer at the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And if you go back to the Depression and the Farm Security Administration, those were government photographers documenting the Depression and the famous photos that we all know from the Depression era. So I kind of had that sense of history. David and I joke a lot, but I was inspired by David and his access and literally my first day on the job was down in Florida with Vice President Bush, and he was greeting his grandson for the first time in this hotel suite, and no one was there but myself and the president and Jeb Bush, his son, and the grandbaby, and I was like, if I don't go in there and take those photos, I may as well go home. So I went and did that, and a few weeks later, I got a note from Barbara Bush saying she loved the photos, and as long as I take pictures of her grandchildren, I can do anything I want. So I actually still have that note. But I always saw it as pure history, because I had that government experience. And I think I really have a sense of that, and to this day, I still, as I'm out and about taking pictures just for myself, I actually send stuff back to the U.S. archives and put stuff out on the internet, because I'm really passionate about documenting stuff. So that was my case.
Yeah, and I think what's great is if you ever get a chance to go to any of the presidential libraries, and I know you went to the Kennedy Library today, you'll see all of our photographs, and that's the historical part of what we got to do. And so, you know, I guess if you look at it, we were working for the American people, but you don't really think about that when you're in that job, although I got great pleasure. You know, in these jobs, as you see all our great documentary work, we don't often talk about the hundreds and hundreds of receiving lines that we also photograph in this job. So there's tons of people that come through the White House, rope lines. And one of the pleasures I really got was being able to send those pictures to that person who shook hands with the president, because I knew how much it would mean to them. So that, you know, it was, that I guess that's how, you know, you might say that we'd work for the American people and really feel it. So I got pleasure out of doing that. But, yeah.
Well, in my case, it was pretty clear that I was serving President Bush. I mean, I was his personal photographer. And my approach to covering him was, it was always his comfort level in terms of my presence, because I didn't want to be part of the scene. You know, I was lucky to be the trained observer to step back and not be a participant, but to document what was happening in front of me. But I had to develop trust. And coming from the press side, I was a press photographer, had to be more aware of so many other things when I became the White House photographer. And for example, after 8 years, all I had to do was look at the president's face to know if I needed to be there, if I could be there or not, if I heard his tone of voice, for example, I knew if he was having a good day or a bad day. There's so many other things to be aware of, including the fact that you're representing the White House, and you're representing, when you travel abroad, you're representing the United States. So you have to be very diplomatic when you're dealing with situations where, let's say you're in a foreign country, they don't see the White House photographer in the same light in terms of the access. But, you know, you can't, you know, you have to be diplomatic because you're representing the United States. So there are a lot of things to consider when you become the White House photographer.
I never got that memo.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
I'm Camila Chavez Cortez, and I'm an artist, a photographer too. And I'd like to know, when you go back, if any of you have had an experience when you went back to look at your negatives, you have more information in these negatives than you ever imagined, and they could have a great impact on public policy. Has that ever happened?
Well, all our negatives are in the libraries, so it's luckily they're not in my basement in boxes with all my other.
No, I understand they are in the libraries, but when you check look at your negatives after you took the photographs, you found something really special there that was not there when you took the photograph. And
that's a great question, and I'll answer. I did a book on, finally, after all these years, on President Ford's administration. It was 2.5 years. So Eric was there for 8 years. Dave was there for 4. How long were you there?
6.5.
So I like had the most compressed time, but when I did the book, I went back to edit. I went through everything. It took me 2.5-3 weeks of just starting at the beginning. And all of a sudden, from a 30-year vantage point, there's Dick Cheney, the 34 28-year-old chief of staff or deputy chief of staff who then became vice president. Rumsfeld was chief of staff, then became secretary of defense, then became secretary of defense later. All these people have, a lot of people from the 4 days really have gone on to other things, and that totally changed the view of the time, which is what you're saying, right? And but one of my best finds was when Richard Nixon was being impeached by the Judiciary Committee. I went back and looked through all my negatives of the House Judiciary Committee meetings in 1974, and there was this woman wearing a bad paisley shirt and big glasses, and her name was Hillary Rodham. And she was working for John Doerr as a young lawyer on the Rodino Committee. And so you never want to throw any pictures out. Every time you hit the delete button, you never know who's going to go into the atmosphere. And so that was one of the great things about film. It's all there, and it's very important stuff.
My name is Dominic. I'm a photojournalist here in Boston. But I wanted to know, I know you guys talked about the sensitivities and being aware of what the president is feeling and thinking, but is there ever a time, can you talk about a moment where you disagreed with the president about what your job was in a certain situation? And basically, the behind that is, what's it like to disagree with the leader of the free world directly?
You become a former White House photographer.
I tell you, we were fishing one time up in Kennebunkport, and it was a summer vacation, and USA Today was counting the days that he didn't catch a fish. And it was like day five, day six on the banner of the USA Today. So I'm in the boat with him, and I'm holding a pole, and I'm falling asleep, and I get a hit, and this fish comes by, and I reel it in, and it comes in sideways, and I got it hooked on the gill. And so I said, oh, I caught a fish. And he said, no, you didn't. You snagged it. That doesn't count. So the next day, we're out again fishing, and he gets a hit, and he's reeling it in, and it's coming in tail first. And so he had snagged the fish on the tail. And he gets the fish in, and he says, call the press boat over. We're going to take a photo. And I said, wait a minute. You didn't catch that fish. And he said, look, it's my boat. I'm president of the United States. Call the press.
That's a great story.
Well done.
Yeah, and did that ever happen to any of the rest of you, where you felt that conflict with the leader of the free world?
I was really lucky to have an incredibly close relationship with the president. And one time, when someone was coming into the White House who had not supported him politically, and it was a big shot, and then the guy called and he was in town, and oh yeah, come on over. And so I was in the elevator going up to the White House, up to the family residence, and the president could see I was really unhappy. And we got off the elevator, and he said, so what's on your mind, Dave? And I said, I'm not gonna name this person, but I said, I'll tell you, that guy really screwed you, and here you are, you're gonna see him. If I were president, I wouldn't see him. And he puts his arm around me, he goes, that's why you're not president, Dave.
Jordan.
Hi guys, my name is Jordan, I'm a sophomore in the college. You guys have all talked about this incredible opportunity you guys had to meet these incredible people, to develop these relationships with these presidents, leaders of the free world. I guess my question is just, have you guys maintained those relationships at all with the presidents?
Yeah, I know in my situation, after I left the White House, I went to head up photography for the Walt Disney Company down in Florida. And former President Bush used to have a Chica Lodge bone fishing tournament down in Isla Mirada, Florida, every year. So I would go down there and photograph that for him. And then you've seen him jumping out of airplanes and in College Station, Texas. So I've gone to that and a handful of things. And actually,
did you jump out with it?
No, I was with telephoto lens. So it looks like I'm. So yeah, over the years, I mean, just about a month ago, they had at the George Bush Presidential Library in College Station. Actually, in my family, we call it the David Valdez Photo Gallery. but they had the 20th anniversary celebration of the freeing of Kuwait, and then we had a little dinner afterwards, and so it was nice to get together and see him. I know you were with the president last night, right? Was it last night?
Two nights ago.
Yep. So I think we all...
I've done, sorry.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, I've done some work for the Bush Library in Dallas, which actually broke ground in November, and I was able to visit with the president and Mrs. Bush. And actually, I made a trip out there pretty early after President George W. Bush left Washington. And what's really nice to see is in the office in Dallas, there are jumbos or the large prints of the photographs that were in the White House. And when I walked in, he said, "See, Eric, we think about you every day." So it was great to see those pictures.
Probably you followed the First Lady, right?
Yeah, so I worked on the Hillary campaign. As we talked about, I've also, whenever the Clintons have come out to Seattle for fundraisers or whatever, I would usually work those. So I kept the relationship up, and I guess it kind of culminated this past summer when I shot Chelsea's wedding. So I got the cover of People magazine. I'll put a plug in for
nice.
That.
Nice.
So I've done that, and actually I'm going to see the president in a couple of weeks. I'm shooting the Clinton Global Initiative meeting at CG. IU, it's at San Diego University, so I'll see him then.
But can we ask one final question? One of the things that struck me, I'm new in my job, I've been here about a month and a half, and it's been about 15 years since I spent this much time on campus, and I've been struck by the videos that I see students producing, putting on the internet, and there's so many more videos today that are being produced and shot, and we're kind of moving to this video world. Maybe in closing, could you each explain why, what is the enduring power of the photograph, and why is it that even with the accessibility of videos, the cost and everything else, why is it that these images, I think, still are powerful and will remain so powerful going forward, even though we now have this live action footage available?
You know, you can sum it up with Eddie Adams' picture when you say the shot of the guy holding the gun to the head of the VC. That once that picture's in your mind, it's there forever, and there's a film of it, but nobody ever remembers that.
I think the only video we all will remember are the planes hitting the Twin Towers. Yeah. Otherwise, you're going to remember still images way over video. And I think that's what we have going for us in mind.
Well, thank you all for your service to America, to your presidents, and thank you for coming tonight.
All right. Thank you.